Dear students, thank you for listening of our videos. These days we present exciting topics around the central nervous system. We said several times that the central nervous system seems to be complicated, but after short time, if you will pay full attention to study of the central nervous system, you will see how logical the system is, how simply it works. So without a long introduction, we are looking at the first pages of the central nervous system lecture. We know from the high school that the central nervous system consists of two main chapters, main parts. Number one is the brain, which is called also cerebrum, or based on Greek terminology, encephalon. The second one is the spinal cord or medulla spinalis. The brain consists of the oldest portion, which is called brainstem, which consists of the mesencephalon, pons varoli, and medulla oblongata, or just oblongata, also cerebellum, responsible for the coordination of the movements. Then, very important part, the encephalon, and finally, the telencephalon, the highest level of the organized brain. Concerning the spinal cord, we remember, this was already mentioned several times, that it has the paired spinal nerves and consists of segments. So these parts were explained together with the explanation of the spinal nerves in the previous lectures. So we try to start now and pay full attention to the number one, spinal cord. Spinal cord, the length of the spinal cord is approximately 45 or 40 to 50 centimeters, and the weight is approximately 30 to 40 grams. It's situated in the vertebral canal, and we also said that the nerves pass through the intervertebral foramina between the vertebrae. Concerning the position of the spinal cord within the vertebral canal, we remember that it's covered by three meninges. Number one is the thickest layer, dura mater, spinalis. Second one is arachnoid. Arachnoid, the name is derived from the word arachne, the spider. So this is much thinner. And finally, the last one is pia. Pia mater lies on the surface, firmly attached to the surface of the spinal cord. Important is also the position. The spinal cord descends morphologically, descends from the foramen magnum, from the greater occipital foramen, to the level L1 or L2. That means the most caudal position is the lower end, and this is called filum terminale. We'll see it in the following diagrams. It hasn't any neurons, so there are no neurons. It's not neural tissue. So we are looking now at the following page. Starting with the diagram. First of all, we see again the level of the foramen magnum, drawing one half only, as usually. And the lower end, we are at the level of L1, L2, or L2 in female vertebral canal. And then the continuation is the filum terminale, as we said, filum terminale. And also, as you see, they are spinal nerves that leave the segment. So we see the spinal nerves. We remember, just for short review, C1 to C8, the segments, cervical, then thoracic, lumbar, sacral, and coccygeal, 31st together. And the nerves descend from the lowest portion, from this area labeled by arrow, and we call it cauda equina, horse's tail. Important also for us is the stability of the spinal cord. We will see that this stability is arranged not only by the meninges, but also by the denticulate ligaments on the next page, on the next diagram, but also the fact that the filum terminale is attached to the tip of coccyx. Looking at the other diagram on the same page, we are looking at the caudal end of the spinal cord. As we said, there are the meninges. So starting with just labeling by dots, the first one is the endosteum, we call it endorachis. You see, endosteum or endorachis, Greek word. This is, in fact, the same layer as the periosteum. So it's endosteum which lines the vertebral canal. We see it on the diagram. Then follows the thicker wall, thicker layer, which is dura mater. Dura mater is in green, and in the space which has numbers one. So it means that space is called epidural. So epidural space contains these bluish dots. These are internal vertebral venous plexuses. We will see also name on the next part. So these are the venous plexuses situated in the epidural space. Then follows a very thin potential space, placing some dots. The space is subdural, between dura, between the green layer, and then the next one, which is the arachnoid. So arachnoid is bluish, also bluish arrow. And then follows the last space with number three, is called subarachnoid. And this subarachnoid is larger, wider. It's between the bluish arachnoid and reddish line pia. So we see also pia mater. And this space contains the cerebrospinal fluid and also the vessels. And the ligaments, we call them denticulate ligaments. These are this one, that one, and so on. So these denticulate ligaments also play an important role in the stability of the spinal cord within the vertebral canal. And if you look at the next page, just the name, internal vertebral venous plexuses, as we said, then the denticulate ligaments, we mentioned both of them. Just revising again the subarachnoid space, which was the largest one, containing the cerebrospinal fluid, then vessels, arteries, and veins. And we remember that the cerebrospinal fluid, as the name says, circulates around the cerebrum and around the spinal cord, is produced by choroid plexus. This is the network of the vessels, complicated composition situated in the vertebral vent, not in only produced by the plexuses situated in the ventricles and circulating around the whole brain and also the spinal cord. Is resorbed in the venous blood. So produced separately and resorbed in the venous blood in the arachnoid granulations. We will speak about these granulations together with the ventricular system and meninges of the brain. Just last word to denticulate ligaments. They are situated only in the coronal position, in the coronal plane, and are responsible, as we said, for stability of the spinal cord. Spinal nerves are also covered by dura mater of spinal cord. We go to the next page. The spinal cord lies in the vertebral canal. This is the reason why we have to mention clinically very important topography or relationships between vertebrae and spinal cord. We call it vertebromedullary topography, which is the relationship of the spinal nerves or spinal segments to vertebral column. No, not to only the whole vertebral column, to spines, because they are palpable. Spines are palpable dorsally. So we see simply the formula concerning the spine or spines in the in the vertebrae, in the cervical portion. So the roots are one more. So that means that the fifth cervical segment is the fourth spine, or vice versa, the fourth spine, cervical spine, C4, corresponds with C5 segment. And the same is its thoracic part, but we adding 3, so that means the T7 is in fact T10. The lower portions, T11, T12, correspond with the L3, L4, and below T12 means that they are the segments corresponding to the order segments of this sacral portion only. The rule describing this relationships is the Schippold's rule, but of course you will see it, you will have it also in your hands in the handouts. Looking back on the cross sections, the fact is that we have to study, although these are very small structures, we have to study also the cross sections. When we look at the cross sections, the thing is that the cross section, we can go a little bit up. Very good. Cross sections help to understand the position, structures, and tracts of the spinal cord. So we start, as usually, drawing just half, just a short description, just looking at the white matter, which forms the posterior fasciculus or funiculus, lateral fascicle, or lies on the lateral side, and also anterior. So there are three white matters, posterior, anterior, and lateral fasciculi. Then the gray matter consists of the dorsal horn. Of course, in the whole extent, we don't call it just horn, we call it dorsal column. Then lateral horn or lateral column. And finally, the ventral horn or ventral column. The gray matter contains nuclei. The white matter consists of the tracts. So the position of the structures must be studied separately. First of all, nuclei, and then after that, white matter, that means tract. So revising, gray matter contains nuclei, white matter forms the tracts. Tracts are interconnections of the neurons. We divide them according to the categories into the ascending, this is the first one in blue, we will use according to the general agreement, blue for the ascending, red for the motor, and the efferent autonomic will be colored by green. So if you look back into the first type, these are the blue, in blue color, the blue tracts. These are called sensory or ascending or afferent. All three synonyms are used. And we divide them into the general sensation, which is touch, pain, etc., and special sensory tracts, which is the vision, hearing, taste, smell, etc. But also they are those transmitting information from the locomotor system, that means from the fibers of the muscles, from the tendons, and also from the capsules of the joints, but also from the periosteum attached to the bone. So from all these parts of the locomotor system run the information via the proprioceptive fibers. We can approach now to the next page. Next one. We start with, as we said, we start with the first section. This is the cross section. The first one was just the general cross section, and now we see the detailed cross section looking now at the nuclei. We will see that it seems to be relatively complicated, but without good knowledge of the position of the nuclei in the gray matter, and after that, we will look into the white matter, that means the tract. So without this information, it should be studied carefully. We cannot explain the following parts of the brain, the brainstem, etc. So please pay full attention to the nuclei. Starting with the posterior horn. Posterior horn receives, as we see, sensory inputs. That means the information from the receptors in any part of the body, not only for the skin, for the internal organs, definitely, but also from the mucosae, etc. The first first nucleus is called posteromarginal. This is number one, the peripheral. Then follows the gelatinous body or substance of Rolando. Concerning the names, usually the authors, we use them traditionally, and they used also preferably in the clinical usage, the clinician, they use these names. So that's why we also put as the last word, last name, this name of the authors. So this is the also sensory substance. Then, so all the sensory inputs pass through this nuclei, they can reach also the larger nucleus, which is called nucleus propius of the posterior column, which is origin of the very important complex of the tracts. We call it spinothalamic tract. So concerning the TR, TR will be used as the abbreviation of the tract, TR dot. So when we will speak in the following text about the spinothalamic tracts, that means they transmit the pain impulses or all the other warning signals. They must pass or originate from this nucleus. The next nucleus, this one, is called dorsal nucleus of Clark, or Clark with the ed, with the E at the end. It is situated in the segments T1 to L3, so that means in the practical, in the whole extent of the spinal cord. Then, so this is the dorsal, we are in the dorsal horn. Then follows the lateral part. Lateral horn contains green nuclei, green color. That means that these are nuclei which belong to the autonomic system. First one is called the intermedial nucleus, intermedial, which is the nucleus that receives the impulses from the viscera. The second one is intermedial lateral, preferably nucleus situated in the segments T1 to L2, and sends as written the visceral motor axons to internal organs, practically the motor descending system, but reaching the smooth musculature of the organs. Then there is the last one, last horn, colored by red, which means that these are the motor nuclei. And look at the smaller drawing here. They are the alpha motor nuclei with the neurons having approximately 100 micrometers. And then the gamma for controlling of the tension, etc. They are smaller, around 60 micrometers. So all these neurons, all these alpha and gamma motor neurons are situated in the anterior horn, which is here. And when we look at the location of the nuclei, we divide as here in the interrupted line indicates the position. We describe and divide them into the lateral group. They innervate muscles of the limbs found in the segment C4 to T1 and L2 to S3. And then the medial group, as we see, innervating muscles of the trunk and situated, as you see, C1 to C3, T2 to T12. So corresponding with the numbers as of segments, as we mentioned here. So summarizing the facts, that drawing, that diagram showing the half of the spinal cord, ignoring now the posterior, lateral, and anterior portion of the white matter, is fully devoted to the gray matter nuclei. We have the posterior horn nuclei, this which receive the sensory inputs. Important would be the nucleus propius of posterior column, origin of the spinothalamic. Then very important dorsal nucleus of Clark, which is responsible for the transmission of the proprioception from the locomotor system. Then the lateral horn consists of the medial, intermedial, and intermedial lateral nuclei, especially that one sends the impulses from the segments T1 to L2 to the internal organs, as we said. And finally, the motor nuclei situated in the lateral group innervate the muscles of the limbs, and those situated on the medial side innervate the muscles of the trunk. There is also one small central group is not in detail described the function of this group. Instead, the nuclei, as we have described in the gray matter, we used also in clinical medicine the laminae of Rexet. This is the next part. So we go to the next page showing the laminae of Rexet. Yes. This is sufficient at the moment. When we look at the laminae of Rexet, they correspond with the position of the nuclei. So simply, we see the bluish area with laminae from 1 to 6, which are sensory, completely sensory. Then number 7 is autonomic, both sympathetic and parasympathetic. And then from 8 to 10, we see the motor area, including also the central portion. So simplifying it, we could say that laminovrexate is another type of the terminology or classification of the gray matter. So we can approach to go to the section number 3, next page. And this is, as you see, white matter. Oh, it seems to be very complicated. It's true, there are so many tracts, so many chains of the neurons. But if you look at the organization, this is not that complicated. We try to start with the posterior. So first of all, we see the posterior part of the white matter forming the laminae, then follows the lateral funiculus, fasciculus, and finally the anterior. So all three have many or contain many tracts. If you look at the bluish one, so starting with that blue area, we call it posterior fasciculi, and they are named according fasciculus gracilis for these two, and fasciculus cuneatus for these two lateral ones. So you see the letters S, L, T, and C. It's easy because just look on the bottom of the page, you see the segmental organization of these posterior funiculi. S means sacral, L means lumbar, T thoracic, and C cervical. So all these tract belong to the posterior fasciculi, which transmit impulses of the following categories. This is discriminative touch. We can distinguish between the touch on the lips, on the face, etc., at any part of the body, and also proprioception. So discriminative touch and proprioception, these modalities are transmitted via the posterior fasciculi. We see two small islets. We call them descending collaterals or descending fields. You see, all these bluish ones must be ascending, definitely, passing from the sacral, lumbar, thoracic, and cervical segments. But some of them descend also, as these two fields descend to the lower segments. So usually, in general, the bluish ones, they are ascending, passing into the higher segments, passing into the, finally into the brain. But they are descending collaterals that also interconnect the neighboring lower segments. So then we are looking at the lateral, larger lateral. It's too long, so again, lateral is from here. Simply we see the inputs in blue and outputs in red. So between these two lines, we see the lateral fasciculus. Lateral fasciculus contains important and large tracts. Number one is the lateral, as you see, corticospinal tract. It's also called pyramidal because there are two. One is also anterior. That's why we use the word lateral corticospinal. The lateral corticospinal tract has also segmental organization, sacral, lumbar, thoracic, cervical. Then, close to that, descends the rubrospinal from the large nucleus situated in the mesencephalon. It's called nucleus ruber, red nucleus, also descending, so that must be red. Then the larger, bigger areas occupied by bluish. So this P and this A means posterior and anterior spinocerebellar tracts, which are the proprioceptive pathways, we said, reaching the Clarke's nucleus in the gray matter, in posterior horn of the gray matter. And finally, there is another important tract, which is called lateral spinothalamic, bluish. This is that one, lateral spinothalamic, large one, with the same segmental organization, cervical, thoracic, lumbar, and sacral. So we see that these are the largest tract, lateral corticospinal and lateral spinothalamic. As with the lateral corticospinal runs also another descending rubrospinal tract, together with the lateral spinothalamic descend also spinoolivary, spinoreticular and spinotectal. At the moment we just register the names because all of them practically transmit similar impulses. It's written here, these are nociceptive. Again, I'm using thick line, not quite straight, nociceptive, which means the impulses which are the pain, the other warning signal. So this, they are those informing about the danger. So nociceptive are very important old reflexes which protect the human beings. This whole complex is called lateral fasciculus lateral complex. And then the last one is the anterior fasciculus. This anterior complex of the tracts consists of mainly motor. We start from the first one, reticulospinal. This will run from any part of this reticular formation, as you see it, FR, formatio reticularis, reticular formation found in the brainstem, also part of the spinal cord. So it's called reticulospinal, descending to the spinal cord, to the motor nuclei, and then also the vestibulospinal, which will be connected with the balance information from the vestibular nuclei, and then also the anterior corticospinal. This is the second pyramidal tract, because that one is larger, lateral corticospinal, segmental, but that anterior is not segmental, it's anterior corticospinal. And the last one, colored by red, is the tectospinal, from tectum, from the highest part level of the mesencephalon. So these are motor. And we have here also sensory, important is anterior spinothalamic, again nociceptive. This is the same as this lateral spinothalamic, but lateral is segmental, as you see, the anterior is not segmental. So we see that the biggest tracts, pyramidal is lateral and pyramidal is anterior. There is lateral spinothalamic and anterior spinothalamic. No, and there is the last one in yellow. We see the medial longitudinal fasciculus, MLF. We will draw it in the same or similar position in all the sections. And this medial longitudinal fasciculus is important for the cooperation between the sensory stimuli coming from the organ of hearing, organ of vision, and also with full coordination with the muscles of the neck. So then we are looking at the or trying to identify the signals or sounds coming from one side by the eyes, by the change of the position of the head or the whole body. Another yellow line or band is the band surrounding the whole gray matter, and we call this narrow band intersegmental tracts, intersegmental or proper fasciculi. These intersegmental tracts are important as the cooperation or the places or tracts which cooperate, or better, which provide the cooperation between the neighboring segments. We will see in the following pages that the reflexes are based on the cooperation of many segments, not only one. So that's why these fasciculi or proper fasciculi play this important role in the cooperation between neighboring segments of the spinal cord. So this is all to the white matter showing the main tracts. Then on the next page, we see summary of the segments. As we said, the segmental organization correct. We said that this was already mentioned, sacral, lumbar, thoracic, cervical. We have seen these segments in many parts of these larger tracts. We divided the tracts, because now we speak briefly about the classification of the tracts. We will see the motor, which are descending, and then more complicated are the sensory, which are divided according to the quality of the information, impulses, or modalities. We divide them into the tactile, which transmit touch impulses, then discriminative touch in the posterior fasciculus. We said that means they pay. We pay full attention to the different areas of the body, and we are able to decide what kind of the pressure of touch is it. Then the next category are the nociceptive or protopathic. Both synonyms are used, and this protopathic transmit pain, heat, cold. They are represented by the spinothalamic tracts. And finally is the third category, proprioception from the muscles, tendons, which are called spinocerebellar tracts. So these are three categories: tactile, discriminative touch, number one, nociceptive, this is number one, nociceptive, number two, warning signals, as we said, and then proprioception. A good example are the spinocerebellar tract. Concerning the explanation of the principal segmental reflexes, so we see it on this diagram, on this page. If you try to move it a bit up, very good. So then we see one segment from on front, starting with the receptor. You remember the somatic reflex arch receptor number one, then ascending motor sensory neuron number two, as we said. Then number three, we are the spinal cord at the center of the reflexes, CNS number three, then motor neuron number four, and finally motor end plate number five as the effect. So this is typical somatic. So we can use the same numbers for explanation of the typical reflex with cooperation of higher or lower segments. So starting with the reflex, transmitting, for instance, pain, because this is a free nerve ending, via the ascending neuron, we approach to the posterior horn, to the nucleus proprius, or one of the other. Pain definitely must end in this nucleus, and in this nucleus is interrupted via the interneuron, and then reaching either motor or better the autonomic system, which is in the lateral horn, or as you see, can go up to the other levels. So via, without entering the whole system, it passes through the lateral spinothalamic, ascending to the higher levels. So you see the arrows, different ones. So these ascending neurons reach the neighboring segments, or even they go up to the brain. Definitely it must reach the brain, because we have to register the pain coming from either from the mucosa or from the surfaces of the body, from the skin, etc. So as together then from the brain descend the motor impulses. I am drawing the line on the opposite side, in which reach the motor neurons, and either on one side or on the opposite side, the neurons reach the motor end plates. So there are two neurons usually in the motor ones, one from the brain and reaching the alpha motor neurons in the anterior horns, and the second neuron usually ends in the effector, which is in this situation, in this diagram, motor end plate of the skeletal muscle. So just again summarizing the fact, we start from receptors, then the ascending pathway lies either at one segment, as we see it here, or via the specific tract, as for instance lateral, or it could be also anterior. Spinothalamic lateral is situated here, anterior would be here. So via this spinothalamic tract, the information ascends into the different levels of the spinal cord, and finally reaching the brain cortex, acesitriptan. So it goes to the thalamus, via thalamus to the brain cortex. All these details will be explained in the following chapter of the spinal cord, or better, into the brainstem. So this was the introduction into the spinal cord. We could say that spinal cord is important reflex center, as we see in this diagram. All the important reflexes are interconnected, or reflexes provide the interconnection with the brain, with the different levels of the brain, with the reticular formation and many other structures. So for us, as the principal information will remain that the spinal cord contains the structs in the white matter and contains many nuclei in the gray matter, which could be also informed or organized as the rexate laminae. Thank you for attention at the moment.